church. If you're just entering, come and find a spot, sit down. My name's Pastor Jess. I'm your service meeting leader here this morning. If it's your first time, church doesn't normally look like this, but that's okay. We can do things differently from time to time. Okay, so the reason that I deliberately chose a song that most of you wouldn't know, so you wouldn't know the words, is because I've been really challenged this week on how worship isn't just, praise and worship isn't just the words we say. Often it's really easy for us to think, well, I come to church, and you know, if you've been to church for a long time, you know all the right things to say, right? Like, we're pretty good at that. We can also be really good at standing there doing this and have our mind somewhere else. But worship is really about what's in our heart, and what's in our heart is expressed in how we live, in how we do things. Worship comes out in our actions. And I think this week we've had this really beautiful opportunity to see worship at play on the world stage. Like, you know, we've seen these processions of people walking kilometres to bow to a casket. If that's not worship, I don't know what is. You know, walking that far just for a momentary bow. And that's for a person who, all respect to the Queen, she's not there anymore, you know. Who watched the funeral service the other day? Yeah, man, that funeral service, that was full of worship for Jesus. How good was that? But that whole procession as well, the way that they carried the coffin, I was watching it and it made me think of in 2 Kings when David calls for the ark to be brought back into Jerusalem. And, you know, there's this procession of singing and dancing and music, and David's sacrificing every six steps or whatever it is, and he's dancing before the Lord. There was no dancing for the queen, but it was that same kind of reverence that was happening there. We also got to see worship on the weekend in Australia when they paraded a nice silver cup through the streets of Melbourne. You know, Australians are really good at worshipping football, am I right? Yeah, people will line up in Melbourne weather for a glimpse of a football player or a glimpse of a cup. And so when we worship, we do something. So lots of people say, I'm going to worship Jesus, but that's actually got to be outworked in our actions, not just what we say. And I want to show you a little clip. It was actually shared this week on our Lighthouse Instagram page. This is from a pastor in America called Levi Lusco. And his church is actually currently doing a series on the Hebrew words for worship. So this week, last week, they were doing the word yada, which is hands raised. And we've just got, I think it's about 90 seconds, a few things he had to say on that.
Praise.
7% is the words we say when we communicate with people. And we come to church and we sometimes think that it's okay to just sing the words. And I'm not saying you have to be so fully expressive that you're doing your own little dance party here, because some people are not like that and that's okay. Some of you might want to do a dance party. But I do wonder if we all thought about how expressive we are when something really good happens, like your team did win the AFL Grand Final or anything, how expressive you get then, and if that translates into how expressive you are when you stop and reflect on what it is that God has done for us. And, you know, when you think about who God is and that He is good God Almighty, that kind of makes it hard to stand still. It makes you want to lift your hands and be like, woo, yeah, let's go. He's a good, good God. Amen? Yeah, I'm going to pass over to Pastor Tim right now. He's going to chat a little bit more about worship.
Thanks. Welcome, everyone, church. What a great Sunday. Good to see the house full this morning. I've got some more discussion on worship to follow on what we spoke about last week. And you know, last week we spoke about what the Greek and Hebrew words for worship were, and that the most common words, I hope if I turn this on, there we go, the most common words in the Greek and the most common words in the Hebrew for what worship actually means is the same thing. All right, the most common word means for worship to be kneeling, to be prostrate. Again, it's that physical act of how do we position ourselves to worship God. And this is daily. This isn't just a once-off occurrence. This is what we do every day when we wake up. We're in worship to God. How are we positioning our bodies in worship? The Bible can also tell us that worship is to sing. It is to stand. It is to speak, to hold out your hand, giving thanks to God, to raise your head, to lift your hands, and to dance. And today, I want to unpack Romans 12, the Apostle Paul, where he says, therefore, he says, I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. What does that actually mean? This morning, I want to unpack that together so we can grasp actually what this means to worship God, what our spiritual act of worship is. Because when the Apostle Paul says, I appeal to you, right? We see in Philemon when he says, accordingly, though I am bold enough in Christ to command you what is required, yet for love's sake, I prefer to use the word appeal, right? So again, come back to love. When Paul's talking to us, he's talking to us in love. He appeals to us. He could command us that this is how we're meant to live. But he goes, no, for the sake of love, for the sake of what Christ has done for us, in love I come to you, brothers, and I appeal to you, right? Based on, because remember when we see the word therefore, we always have to ask ourselves, what's it there for, right? It's there because of what he's just said in chapters 1 to 11. And he's talking about the mercies of God. So we have to take that into context. So before we can unpack this scripture, we need to understand that he's just spoken for 11 chapters on how merciful God is to us. And that's why he says, I appeal to you from the bottom of my heart with everything. Will you please grasp this? God has been so merciful to us. Therefore, brothers, he says, by the mercies of God. Right, Jesus brought an end to the Old Testament idea of sacrifice. It's done. We don't have to sacrifice in that way anymore. Jesus finished the great work of atonement. His death cannot be improved on. We do not add anything to what he's done for us. It's already done. So we are worthy. We can stand together today knowing that we are. So when Paul said to present our bodies as a sacrifice, what does that actually mean? I want to look at these four words today. Bodies, living, holy, and acceptable to God as we pull this bit of scripture apart. The body, the sacrifice of our body is to God, right? Our bodies, we need to be presenting them to God. It's not a sacrifice for sin. That's already been done. Jesus has done that. Like I said, we can't add to that. But we need to present our bodies. Yes, he wants your body. You go, my body is not that holy. My body is not that amazing. My body is full of yuck. Didn't when they present a sacrifice, wasn't it pure? Wasn't it the very best? Sometimes we can feel our bodies aren't the best, right? But that's Old Testament. Now we present our bodies as we've been asked to, because God cares about our bodies. In 1 Peter 2, 4 to 5, he says, as you come to him, a living stone rejected by men, but in the sight of God, chosen and precious. You yourselves are like living stones being built up as spiritual houses to be a holy priesthood. This is your body being built up to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. Don't forget that. That's the most important thing. Through Jesus Christ. Okay? If we are acceptable, it is through Jesus Christ. Through his perfection, not ours. We're not looking for a perfect people. We're looking for a devoted people that are willing to worship our God and our King. We're not offering our bodies by what they look like to God, but our bodily behavior is what we offer to God. What are you doing with your body every day of the week? Because that is what we offer to God, our bodily behavior in worship. Biblically, the body is significant because of not by the way it looks, because this body here looks amazing, right? You're all beautiful people. And you're all such wonderful people to be around. But biblically, we need to always come back to what does the Bible tell us to do and behave and how do we obey the very words of Jesus. But the body is significant biblically because of the way the body acts. This is why we're getting into the gifts of the Spirit. This is why we're getting into your gifts, what God has given you, because it's so vital to show that the community that don't yet know Jesus, how the body of God operates, how beautiful it is. The body is given to us to make visible the beauty of Christ. That's this body. That's your body, right? John Piper says that so beautifully. The whole reason that we have church is to make visible the beauty of Jesus Christ. Come on, how good is that? Where else would you rather be? Christ's beauty was the beauty of sacrifice, not the beauty of his looks. His beauty is love. Paul was saying that Christ wants visible, lived out bodies, bodily evidence that our lives are built on his mercy. And that's what we just spoke about before, chapters 1 to 11. It's all about the mercies of God. Old Testament worshippers would worship with sacrifice. Our sacrifice is done. We don't do that anymore. Now we offer our bodies. We offer this body of people as a worship to God to show the community how amazing Jesus Christ is. That's why unity is so important. It wraps everything up. Like you can just see when we grasp the reality of how God views the body, we can see how much more of the word lines up with why he wants us to act in such a way. Why he doesn't want us to hold grudges against each other. Why he doesn't want division. Because if it's to show the world the beauty of Christ, unless we're operating in his love, how can we do that? So when we deny ourselves some earthly treasure or comforts, and carry ourselves, our bodies, for Christ's sake, to the places and relationships and the crises in the world where mercy is needed, that is worship. Living. What does it mean to live? It's our living that is our act of worship. Every act of our living will be a demonstration to the world that God is our treasure. How are you living today? Every opportunity, every day, his mercies are new every day. We get to repent of what we did wrong yesterday, what he corrected us on, and start again afresh in his mercies again today. You know, it's like when you go down the beach and it's been high tide and the tide goes out and the sand's just beautiful and no one else has been on it. Everything washed away. That's how he views us. Do we live that Christ is more precious to us than anything else? Because that is how we live worship. Or does our life look like other things are more important? And if anyone from the world was to meet us, would they know that Jesus is just our everything and our all by the way we live? Because that's how we worship. This is what he's asking us to do. He's pleading with us, please guys, live this life where Jesus is everything, that nothing else matters. Don't let anything get in the way of Jesus. Don't let anything get in the way of the body. Don't let anything get in the way of who you're meant to be. And it's so easy to let things creep in. But daily, we come back to the heart of repentance in worship to him. Holy, Romans 6:13. Do not present your members to sin as instruments for unrighteousness. Thereby members is meaning your body, your parts of your body, your eyes, your ears, your mouth, what you say, your hands, what you do, where you go, your feet, where it takes you. Don't present your members to sin as instruments for unrighteousness, but present yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life. Again, Romans 1 to 11, the mercies of God. God showing us what he has done for us. And your members to God as instruments for righteousness. Our bodies are not holy because of what they look like, but because of how they act. Compassion. mercy, grace, love, forgiveness. When new people come into church, how does the body embrace them? Are you quick to go to someone that you know and you're familiar with, or are you quick to get onto that new person to show them Christ's love and how He died for them? And how much you just love the fact that they came here because you're so excited to be with the body, acting as the body, to show the world who Jesus is. Is that your core focus? Because that's what He's calling us to do, as worshiping Him every day. Acceptable to God. Present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. The reason that holiness matters is because it brings in God. These words are describing an act of worship, which is your spiritual worship, your act, what you're physically doing. And God needs to be at that center. Not footy, not our careers, not our family, nothing else. Just God. Acceptable to God, to make God explicit. He is the only one. He's the whole reason why. In Philippians 1, verse 20, it says, "As it is my eager expectation and hope that I will not be at all ashamed, but with full courage, now as always, Christ will be honored in my body, whether I live or die." Whether by life or death, that all that matters is that we exalt Jesus. 1 Corinthians 6, 19 to 20. "Or do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit who lives within you, whom you have from God? You are not your own anymore. You were bought with a price. So we're to glorify God in our bodies." Would you join with me this morning as we really take ownership of what worship looks like? And we've got a couple of songs this morning. One we haven't had in church before. Many of you might know it. It's called "The Cause of Christ," and the words be on the screen. But position ourselves. Yeah, the tables are different this morning, but we can position ourselves still before God. You can leave your seat and find somewhere else in the church if you need to. To position yourself before Him. How's your heart with Him today? Do you need to repent? And that's great, because every day I need to repent and come before Him. God, Father, forgive me for what I've done. And then offer your body wholeheartedly to worship. Offer this body, your family, in worship. Join with one another and let's worship our King this morning. Thanks, Jace. Let's pop that first song on.